Hi everyone. Yeah, I think my sound is also on. Pleasure to be here. So today I will be speaking about international SEO. So SEO in general, it's a free way of getting traffic to your website. And in general means traffic means also more sales. And this talk is specifically about international SEO. And here in the UAE, usually every website is both in Arabic and in English. So that's why it's very should also be relevant to you. Just short about me. So I'm working since 11 years in international SEO, and I work for clients as Randstad, Philips, McAfee, and this is my background. So just with regards to global versus local, so although it's called international SEO, actually what we're trying to do is that the person who is coming on the website has a very local feeling. So if somebody is searching for from the UAE, it comes to the website, it should look if it's a website which is originated from the UAE. Same if it's, for example, from Kuwait. It should really like a website which is coming from there. So really like localized. And the aim of that is that the website gives more trust. And with more trust, you also usually get a higher conversion rate, so more sales. So one of the things what can be localized is the images which you will be using on your site. This is an example of Nike, but it's like in the campaigns, on your website, but it depends on which region, which country are you targeting. Local language, very important. One thing, for example, for Randstad, they had their website only in English, and they were targeting Saudi Arabia, and that doesn't work. Like, you really need to have the website in the language of the local country. Another thing is, for example, contact details. So if somebody searching from the UAE sees a UAE phone number, it gives more trust and therefore higher conversion rates. Currency is very important. Imagine if you are in the website in the UAE, but you see, for example, the currency from Saudi. Like, it's confusing. So that's one thing to be aware of. And also, yeah, what you just mentioned about GDPR as well. It's very important to be up to date of local laws. So even within the same language, it applies to English or Arabic or even in Spanish versus Spain and Latin America, there are differences per country. So although the language is the same, different words are being used, for example, in Egypt versus here. So that's good to you to be aware of. And one app which I like to use a lot if I go to new countries. For example, I went to Japan a few months ago to give their training. And then I used the Culture Compass to understand what are the difference compared to me versus the country which I'm visiting. So this is applicable to the style of communication, also the style of management. So in the US, it's very common to have employee of the month because it's more like an individualistic culture. But if you go to countries as Japan, it's more as a group, collectivistics. So if you dare leave one person out of the group, yeah, you are the best of this month, it can make feel that person very awkward, because now he's not part of the group anymore, you place him above. So that's good to be aware of. So therefore, I like to use this app for it. I also, in the last slides, I have a link of the presentation, so then all the red links, you can follow them and download the app. So just, if you're targeting multiple countries, it's usually Google who you're dealing with, because Google has a market share of 92% around the globe, but it depends very much on which country are you operating in. In, for example, Russia, it's Yandex, in China, it's Baidu. So that's good to be aware. And there's a tool where you can check it, which is called StatCounter. So you can fill in your own market. And this is for the UAE. So UAE is usually mainly Google. And it's a trend for over a year. So here you can see that also Google has a quite consistent market share in the terms of search engines. If you would see this, see the same graph, for example, Korea, then you'll see that their local search engine Naver is going down, but that Google is going up. So it's good to check per market. And the reason why you want to check that, to see what are the search engines where you're dealing with, because they could have different guidelines. So, for example, Google uses Ahrefs language tags to say, this is the Arabic page for Saudi, this is the Arabic page for the UAE. Whereas, for example, Bing uses a content language tag. So therefore, it's good to be aware what kind of search engines are there. And also, for example, that you know where to advertise on. So if you need to use Google Ads or also Bing Ads, now Microsoft Ads. And the same tool, StatCounter, you can use it for device research as well. So in case you want to launch an app, and you want to see, so what is the most used device? This was an example of Pakistan, and there the most used device is by far is Android. So in case you want to launch an app, then you know, okay, Android is the first priority. And with regards to the international SEO, there are a couple very important choices to make when you have your website, and that is how your website is being set up. There are multiple ways, but two are the best ones. One is to have a local TED, so in the case of Philips, where they have philips.ae, philips.se for Saudi, so it's the extension at the end. Another thing, reason why this is very important is because a local, like the country extension, gives a signal that this website is really made for the UAE, so it's a ranking factor. The second option of Samsung, samsung.com/AE, that misses the factor of local, that it's meant for that local region. But the reason why it's a good choice as well is because it combines all the websites into one strong website, so it has a lot of authority. So if you publish a page under the .com, it's easier to rank than when you have like a separate website. So these are the two best options. Other options, what you have is, for example, a subdomain, which is ae.samsung.com, and this is not recommended. And the reason why is that the subdomain is being seen as a separate website who needs to build up like own authority, own domain strength, so it's better to choose either one of these two options. If you already have one of these options in place, then it's usually not worth of switching to the other one, because with every site migration, there are risks, so then it's better to stay on either of these two choices. And then, so when you have your domain set up, the next one is language folders. So Google needs to know that these pages are a certain language. So what is very common is, for example, in this case, ENSA, which stands for English in Saudi. So then Google knows, okay, everything that comes under this language folder, it's the English version for Saudi. The only question, do you see something here which is not correct on this image? Like if this page is being made for Saudi, what should have not been here? Yeah, also, and let me see if I can point. Yeah, so also here you see applies to prices in US and Canada. This should have not been there because this page is not being shown in US and Canada. It's a page being shown in Saudi. So therefore, this information could be just shown about Saudi and Saudi prices. So that's the benefit of having having a page separately for a country, that you can really optimize it. So normally, if you create content, for example, you have a page in Arabic about shavers for the UAE, and you also launch a page for Saudi about shavers, then Google sees it as duplicate content because you have the same text across multiple pages. One way to prevent that Google sees is that duplicate content is Ahrefs language tags. So that specifies like these pages are belonging together, but this is the Arabic version for the UAE, and this is the Arabic version for Saudi. So that's why if you have the same language across multiple markets, so if you have Arabic pages for multiple markets, same with English, then it's very important to use these Ahrefs language tags, and then it's all fine. Ahrefs language tags only work when they refer to each other. So if you have a separate website for the UAE and you have a separate website for Saudi, then they need to, I prefer to do it in the XML sitemap. They need to link to each other. So the UAE sitemap needs to say, this is the page for UAE, this is the page for Saudi. And the Saudi website needs to say, this is the page for the UAE. So then Google knows, okay, these ones are belonging together and are correctly implemented. One way to check, like, is it issue present? Do I have other locales ranking in my market? So this was an... I changed the name, but it was example Philips. So it's you can search for your own name, and then you can see in a particular market, you can see which other websites are ranking in my market. And then I could see for the keywords which I'm tracking, this is from the Conductor tracking tool, I can see on view ranks, and then I can see for which words are other locals ranking in my market, and do I need to, are my Ahrefs language tags installed correctly, or do I need to make some other changes? Just, it's important to know that Ahrefs language tags works on the same pages, but if the user has a different intent, then it still can appear that another local will rank in your market. So in, this, in the case of Philips, they had a page about recipes for the Middle East, and then they said, yeah, but when I search on chicken recipes, then the Australia version comes up in the Middle East. But then it turned out that the Middle East didn't have a page about chicken recipes. So it's very, it's also the question, do I have a page where the user is searching for? Do I have it on the website? If you have your, if you're serving multiple markets, it's very good to make use of a content delivery network because that, if you have your website hosted in the UAE, but you visit, you're serving clients in the US or in other parts of the world, via a content delivery network, the website is loaded from a server which is around the user, so it provides a much more faster loading time. So that's why, if you're searching, serving your company globally. It's very good to use a content delivery network. Just only thing, comment is here, if you targeting China, then you need to have your hosting in China, because otherwise it can add up up to 20 seconds of extra loading time if you have your server outside of China. And one thing as well, so I'm from Europe where we always have very fast internet. But then I went to Egypt, and the internet was very, very slow. So it's also with, when you're designing your website, it's good to think about, so how, even if markets with slow internet, how can I still provide like a very good experience to my users? So one thing, one way is via mPages, that stands for Accelerated Mobile Pages. It's a simplified version of the HTML, and it has a couple of restrictions. But that makes the pages very fast. So in case one way of dealing with slower internet is to look into the option, like can we create mPages for these markets. Does any of you, already use mPages, Accelerated Mobile Pages? Yeah, very good, very good. So that was more on the technical side, but from the content, so usually if you work in from a global company, you want to drive content, or you want markets to stimulate to add content to the website. So one of the things to know where should I create content for is to do a keyword research. And usually when I do that, I create like one master version. I have the global search volume that I know like which topics are popular across the world, and then I specify it out per country in the same language. So I know if I want to write content or I want to optimize pages, I know where to start. So from a global, I usually start here. So I have like a content calendar. This is the topics where I'm going to create content for, and then spreading them with the markets, and the markets can either like use them directly or localize them so it really makes sense to their markets. But it could also be the other way around, and this is usually also happening with the Middle East, because, for example, Ramadan is very large here. A lot of companies do campaign around that month, whereas in Europe it's smaller. So there, if, for example, UAE would create content about it, recipes, actions, then it can also be used for the whole Middle East. So that's why you have like a two-side approach. One is from local, and one is from global to really drive content to add to the pages. And content is accounting for 40, or it has a very large impact on the ranking. So therefore, we always try to stimulate markets to really add more content to the site where people are searching for. And one thing to be also in keep in mind when you do translations is that certain languages, they are longer in length for the same meaning as another language. So this is example for US, free shipping and fast delivery. And the one below is for Germany, which is way longer already. So that you see here an example of Amazon, that the country is not listed here anymore. So that's good to be aware of as well. So you can also field here like the UAE, so the user sees the country directly. And this is also applicable for if you have buttons on your website or like a header that doesn't fall off the page. And from a more organizational structure, so for content and for outreach, so the link building, there you really need to have local market expertise, because you need to know like what are the topics which are interesting in the markets. You need to know the local language, like traditions. Technical SEO, that should be done by like one person or like a central team, because that's the same across all markets. So therefore, to be most efficient, that should be grouped together. And when you have like the content and the outreach done by markets, it's still very important to like educate them, give them trainings to make sure that it is aligned and to also create the benefit of like of skill of operating in multiple markets and combining the knowledge together. And backlinks is always a very sensitive topic in SEO, because it's also the most dangerous one. So if you do it in an incorrect way, Google can penalize your site, and that could result in that you're, for example, ranking on the first page, but then you're not able to be found anymore. So it's always a very sensitive topic. So therefore, if markets do like, or markets are working more like outreach, PR, campaigning, as a global, as a, like a regional department, it's good to perform regular checks, like are they doing it like white hat, so good practices, or are they buying links and like which oppose risk to the whole website. And usually when I have my my action plan, I always plot them into for like low effort, high value. That area is usually the ones where I start with. So any like optimizations, I plot them across this graph, and then it gives me like a roadmap or like a timeline where I should start and what are the most important ones. And just one recent update what I wanted to share. It's same as you create stories for Facebook and Instagram. You can also now create stories for your website. So that is via M Stories. So here I have the link as well. So when you get back to the presentation, you can read more about it. But this would be interesting to explore as well, because these stories can then come up in the Google, in the search results. So this is still very new. I haven't seen this a lot on websites being used, but it's interesting to explore further. So that was it from my side. So just some takeaways. Very important, give that local feeling. So really optimize your website towards a market which you're trying to target. And technical SEO should be managed from a global level, but content and outreach from a local market, also to really give that local feeling. It's important to focus a lot on content creation and adding content to the website, which can be driven both from global, so top-down, as from if one country produces very interesting content, can we leverage it across other markets as well? And from technical, very important to choose the right domain setup because it really matters in your performance. If you, for example, have samsung.ae/sa because you want to target Saudi, then Google sees that this website is for the Saudi people in the UAE. So therefore, the domain setup is very, very important one. And also to use language folders. Ahrefs language text, very important to make sure that the correct version, so for example, the Arabic for the UAE is ranking in the UAE, and the Arabic for Saudi in Saudi. And to use a content delivery network. And AMP is very important to explore further. And that was it from my side. Oh yeah, and here I have the link towards where you can see the presentation. Any questions?
First of all, thank you for the informative such a session. It's pretty
thank
nice.
You.
I actually wanted to ask, many organizations target multiple countries but with similar languages, especially in the Middle East and Africa.
Mm-hmm.
So what they do is they have a main global site and then they have several mini sites within it for each country, right? So my question is, first of all, if an organization like this has similar information, like if it's an informational site and it has similar information for each of the local countries, doesn't that lead to duplication of content and again, subsequently something that Google would fine you for? And secondly, does that dissolve some of the SEO effort that you put into the global site?
Yeah, so when you say microsites, what is the URL folder? Is it like yoursite.com/ and then the folder?
Yes, like you mentioned that you have www.abc.ae then.
Yeah.
In that case, yeah. But they're navigating from the global site.
Yeah, that's no problem as long as you have Ahrefs language tags. So these tags, especially in the international SEO, they are like crucial to have. Mm-hmm. Because then if you have your global site and you're reusing your same content, you reuse your same content in another country, that's fine, as long as you have these tags in place.
Okay.
Any other?
Thank you for the talk. We have a different challenge. I work for New York University Abu Dhabi.
Mm-hmm.
So we have our own site separate from NYU. But the mission of ours is like we're an English language institution, but we do have an Arabic site. And we don't do that great of a job with SEO because it doesn't really have, like we don't do a copy, right? We don't do a page by page translation.
Yeah.
The Arabic site is more of an informational one
mm-hmm.
because we're trying to stress that if you're coming to our university, English has to be because it's the language of instruction.
Yeah.
So in the SEO, how do we sort of still get the high rates that we get for our English site, yet sort of, because it's a different target type of thing. So I'm like, we've always had trouble of how to do the SEO for that or how to localize it.
Yeah. If the content is not similar because there's a different communication or like different topics, then the Ahrefs language tags are not necessarily required because it's not the same version of the page. Just in the terms of like more traffic, it would always be good to do like a keyword research in Arabic, like what are the people searching for and can we create content which attracts those people to the website and then lead them to the English version because that's the education part.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yep, there as well. Yeah, we have one.
Okay, ma'am, it's about three of the lectures' presentations which you have seen regarding SEOs, and all very informative, all have real good content in it so that we can improve the search engine optimization of our products through our websites. One thing which I have a comment as a comment is, I think in all the three presentations, don't you feel we missed out the connection of SEO with social media? or for example, your first slide shows a Twitter account of one of the website, maybe. Yeah. And if that Twitter account is basically working in Arabic and Middle East, obviously what I feel as a layman, it will increase the search engine optimization. It will definitely help in getting that website popular. What do you think, ma'am? It's a sort of a textbook form that you don't mingle up these two things, the web media and social media, or what's the case?
Yeah, it's a good question. They actually did a couple of research about the impact of social media on SEO. And one thing what it had helped is that if you share something on social media, it gets indexed quicker. So that's one thing how social media can be used. Another thing is that if a lot of people are sharing a certain a topic or an article at a moment on social media, Google knows, okay, this is popular, I need to rank it like higher, but it's usually only like short trends. So if there's, for example, what you usually see is that if something is very shared on social media, it gets like a peak, but then it's like returning back again. So it's for a very short period of time that it... that Google knows, okay, there was something like popular around it, and then it fades, like it stays again, like normal.
Hi, I'm Jacob. When it comes to SEO, be it global, be it local, we literally go in with off-page and on-page optimization for organic SEO. Now, my question here is, do you have any best practices that you necessarily recommend when it turns out to be in global SEO strategies that you deploy, particularly when you are talking about different markets, particularly on the off-page or the backlinking aspect?
Yeah. Therefore, you really need to have your local team need to do this exercise, because they need to know like which websites are very popular. So if I would be in Europe in the global head office, I wouldn't know that, for example, the national, it's a very popular website here. So therefore, for that link building and outreach exercise, it's very important to use the local team.
Local team is fine, yeah, absolutely, by all means, yeah. But not the global team would not necessarily know about what's really happening or the cultural differences that happen internally. But when it comes to the do's and don'ts, per se, of off-page or link-building activities, are there going to be any cultural sensitivities that's got to be looked into?
No, they're quite the same. So that's with SEO, like the guidelines, the restrictions, the things what Google say, they are the same across each market. It's just that the content is differing, but it's the same guideline.
Sure, thank you.
Yeah. Behind you.
Hey Miranda, thanks a lot for this amazing session. I'm assuming that you have done a lot of research around international SEO to come up with all those insights. Can you give us, please, the best example? Who do you consider as like the best brand when it comes to international SEO globally and as well locally? Who would you take as like basically the leaders for these best practices?
That's a very difficult question, because usually even with international, or there's one thing to keep in mind. So usually large brands, they have thought that SEO was not that important for a long time, until they were being caught up by online players. So if you look to large brands, even still like Philips or Randstad also specifically, their international SEO, there's still a lot of work to do, because they started quite late with SEO. So if you look into like a good example, I would look to online players. I wanted to say Amazon, but it's mainly product content. With, for example, Philips, we did a lot of like optimization for local markets. So first there was one website for the whole Middle East region, and we now split it on per website. So each country have their own website, so they can really adapt the content and tailor towards that market. But I find it hard to give one example which to say, okay, they are the best in it. So for the most one, I would say Philips.
Hi, Miranda.
Hi.
Actually, I'm not aware of AMP pages. So will you please tell me what are AMP pages?
Yeah, it's something which is rolled out by Google, or it's an initiative from Google and a couple of companies. And they were rolled out something like 4 years ago. So it's a simplified version of HTML. And therefore, developers are a bit reluctant to use it because it's for them it's a lot of extra work. So what we did with Philips is that we had one page template for the products. And therefore, we created an AMP, an AMP version. And by using one template, we could use it for all the product pages across all the markets. So with minimal work, we had like millions of product pages online. And what we saw is that versus the page which was normally ranking on mobile and versus the AMP page, is that the AMP page had a higher click-through rate, a higher position, and that is cost because it's a faster loading time. So then Google awards it with a higher ranking. So that's likely when you propose this to your technical team, they will say, like, really, do we need it? Can we not make the website just very faster? Because it also means more work for them. But when you start it, I would start with page templates. So not doing every page separately, but only work on page templates. Okay, thank you very much. Pleasure to be here.